Hey, Paul Masetta here with theinfluentialmind.com. And today I want to talk to you about Maverick Influence. You know, I have this group called the Maverick Influence Group. I talk about Maverick Influence. People always ask me, what exactly is Maverick Influence? And the best way that I can describe it is a street smart approach to the traditional psychology of compliance gaining. What does that mean? It means that I've bridged the gap basically between everything that I learned of what works in therapeutic and psychological test case study settings versus what works in real life situations, right? Because what good is it for you to prove that a technique or a strategy works under a controlled circumstance or in a controlled environment if it can't work when you're in a job interview, if it can't work when you need to close a deal, if it can't work when you need to land that important date, when you need to really influence someone in a real life situation? Many of the things that traditional psychology teaches us simply will not work. So today, what I want to share with you is my simple five-step method for Maverick Influence, if you really want to influence someone. Now, here's the thing. A lot of what I'm going to show you might sound like common sense, but like they say, common sense isn't really so common. For whatever reason, a lot of people just miss the mark on this. They overlook it. They're completely ignorant of it. They're lost. They're unaware. They are simply just not paying attention. So what I want to share with you today is my GRIPS method. And the reason why I call it the GRIPS method is because it's literally going to enable you to grip the mind of someone else and direct it where you want it. And I'm going to do it really fast for you. So the first one is gather intelligence. That's the first step in this process. Pretty simple. First of all, I look at life as a game, right? There's really no other way to look at it. You know, it's a game. I could tell you how it's gonna end for all of us. And I don't say that to be depressing or morbid. I say it really so that you can embrace life and realize that you really are only here for a short period of time. So you might as well make the most of it. And it begins with looking at life in some aspects as a game. I'm not saying that you should look at your entire life as a game, but you should begin to look at certain aspects of your life in a game. But when I say that, I mean look at it as a game from an intelligent point of view. Look at it from a strategic point of view. And in any game, whether it be professional sports, professional fighting, any type of game that involves a strategy, there is always a level of intelligence gathering, right? You are always gathering intelligence about your opponent, about their strategy, about your strategy. You don't just walk into a football game, right? So when you watch a football game in the NFL, the players just don't walk on the field and you know, play it by ear and wing it and see what happens. There's a strategy. They've watched the team that they're gonna play. They've studied their most valuable players. They've figured out a way to implement a strategy of their own and then to try to counteract the strategy that they think the other team is gonna come forward with. And we see this throughout virtually any aspect of life that involves winning on some level. So, if you want to influence someone, if you want to persuade someone, if you want to make an impact on that person, why would you skip this step? So many people do. They simply do not gather intelligence about the people that they want to influence. And to me, it's the craziest thing in the world. I can't understand why people overlook this. Now, there are two types of intelligence that you can gather about someone. There is preconceived, and then there is real time. Those are the two different types of intelligence that you can gather on someone. Now, the difference between them is that preconceived intelligence, which in most cases is the best type of intelligence, is when you have a good amount of time to understand and to gather the intelligence and to study the person that you want to influence so that you know so much about them that these next steps that follow are really easy and you really implement them as efficiently and as effectively as possible. So preconceived intelligence is the best kind of intelligence. Unfortunately, sometimes preconceived intelligence is not an option. If you happen to find yourself in a situation where you get presented with an opportunity that you weren't expecting, you're going to have to work on real-time intelligence. Now, there are very in-depth explanations and ways that you can implement this stuff. What I want to give you here is the short version. And the short version is this: preconceived intelligence, start with the basic stuff. You know, they say that 1/3 of the human population has a Facebook account or a Twitter account or some sort of social account. So do a Google search on the person. We live in the age of information, and nowadays accessing information about people is extremely easy. Google the person's name, see if a Facebook account comes up. Now, if a Facebook account or a Twitter account or something like that does come up, you want to take down as much information about this person as possible, and I'll get into that in the second part of this. But those are the types of things that you want to do. You want to gather information about this person either through a social network or maybe a third party if you're having someone introduce you to them. Do some research on the person. Find out what they like, what they don't like, what their hobbies are, what their interests are, where they live, if they have children. Things like that matter when we get into the second part of this. As far as the real-time stuff goes, you have to observe. Pay attention to someone. Observe them, look at them, see what kind of clothing they wear, see what kind of jewelry they wear. You should be very up to date and in sync with current social norms and cultural norms, and try to understand where this person fits in to the category of fashion and trendiness and things like that, and try to gauge a little bit of information about this person based on what you observe from them. Observe their body language. Body language, the way that they dress, makeup, clothing, and jewelry are probably the 4 or 5 biggest things that will give you a key indicator of exactly what type of a person you're dealing with before you move on. The second part is to reduce resistance. People are organically, naturally programmed to want to resist you. Especially if you're trying to influence them, sell them something, or persuade them in some way. People have natural defense mechanisms. Deep within our minds is something called the reptilian brain, which is the oldest part of our brain. It's responsible for flight, fight responses, circulation, breathing, things like that. It's also responsible for protecting us. And so deep within it and deep within us are these desires and these feelings of wanting to protect ourselves from other people. The human mind sums up one person in less than 7 seconds, and most of it happens on a subconscious level. So what happens is when you meet someone for the first time, they basically sum you up in their mind and formulate an opinion about you in less than 7 seconds. And most of the time, it's not a favorable opinion. So the first thing that we need to do is you need to reduce resistance with people. And there are many different ways to do it. Rapport is the best and most effective way to do it. Two easiest ways to create rapport are to, one, avoid differences and highlight similarities. Really simple. Do some research on the person. Take your preconceived knowledge or your real-time knowledge and utilize it. Avoid any differences that you find with the person. Highlight any similarities that you have with them. If you live in the same town with them, if you share the same religious beliefs as them, if you share the same background as them, if you know people that they know, if you are a fan of the same sports team, bring all of that stuff up, highlight it, but do it subtly. More importantly, avoid the differences. That's even more important. So if you're a Jets fan and you know that the person that you want to influence is a Giants fan, avoid talking about football altogether. Avoid religion, avoid politics, avoid things that possibly could blow up in your face unless you know for sure that you share the same views as that person, and then it's something that you can really build on. And one secret that I'll give you is one of the easiest ways to build rapport with someone is to align against a common enemy. So when it comes to religion and politics, and that's something that for the sake of this video, I'm not gonna get into, but, and I don't suggest that you do, unless you know for sure that the person that you're dealing with shares the same political or religious views as you. In terms of political views, if you align with that person against the common enemy, so if you're both Republicans and you align against the Democrats or vice versa, the level of rapport will be strengthened that much more. Next is you want to induce control. And there are various ways that you can induce control. I'll give you a few of the basic ones by telling you that there are two ways that the human mind processes information, two routes that it takes, the central route and the peripheral route. When a person is taking the central route, it means that they're paying very close attention, they're analyzing, they're scrutinizing the information that's coming into them. When they take the peripheral route, they are using mental shortcuts called heuristics. And basically, these mental shortcuts save us from expending all of our cognitive resources, because if we had to think about every single thing that came our way, we would be mentally exhausted. So instead, we take these rapid subconscious shortcuts when we're processing information. Now, because people do that, there's an opportunity to influence them subconsciously by using certain triggers. And that's how you can induce control, by utilizing certain triggers that people respond to subconsciously. One of the biggest ones is scarcity. Have you ever noticed that the moment something is taken away from you, the desire to have it increases? We see this all the time in relationships, especially when two people first meet and they really don't know a lot about each other and they're very curious and there's a lot of mysticism and curiosity. As one person becomes less available, the other person becomes drawn to them. But the minute they profess their love, say that they're committed and jump all in, their desirability suddenly drops. And the reason why is because the spell is then broken. And a lot of this has to do with the survival mechanism. People will do more to avoid loss than they will to gain something. And scarcity equals loss. So the minute people feel like they're about to lose something, they want to act to gain it and to protect it. Again, there are many other triggers that you can use. You can use the comparison trigger, which tells us that the perception of something changes the moment that you compare it to something else. So if you took three buckets of water, hot, warm, and cold, and put your left leg in the bucket with warm water and your right leg in the bucket with cold water, and then put both legs in the bucket with warm water, you would notice that the leg that was in the hot water now feels cold, and the leg that was in the cold water now feels hot, even though you're standing in the exact same bucket of water. What's happening is your brain is sending a signal to the nerve endings in your body, and it's basically telling it that it's experiencing a level of comparison. That is how the comparison trigger works. There are countless other triggers that you can use, but the triggers that are involved in inducing control. So you gather intelligence, you reduce resistance, and then you induce control in various different ways using techniques, tactics, and strategies. The next thing you want to do is position yourself. You want to position yourself to be the person that this person wants to be influenced by. Now listen close to what I'm about to tell you. The majority of your ability to influence someone else has to do with the image that that person has created in their mind about you. And it's your job and your responsibility to do your best to project the best possible image that you can. And you do that by positioning yourself. Realize that most people will only choose to be in your presence or to be influenced by you for one of three reasons. Either A, they have something to gain, B, you're protecting them from losing something, or C, they want to be entertained by you. So in the first two situations, those mostly apply to business situations and things of that nature. And then in the social interactions, when you break down the people that you're really close with, that you have close ties with, friends and family that really have no ulterior motives, they want to be in your presence because you make them feel good. You, in essence, entertain them and you provide something positive within them, right? But there's always something there and it's always one of those three things. So you have to think about how you can position yourself to be the best possible candidate for any one of those possible positions in the mind of the other person. And then the last thing is simply to sustain that position. And this again is another one. Seems like common sense. Most people completely miss the mark on it. Most people, especially in sales, once they close the sale, a very small percentage of salespeople actually stay in contact with the client unless the business that they're in mandates repeat business on a very short-term basis. Most people, most salespeople completely forget about the client after they've sold them whatever they have to sell them. And the same thing happens in settings that do not have anything to do with business. A lot of times two people connect. They form a relationship, one person does a favor for someone, one person's influenced, one person's persuaded, and the person that did the influence and persuading fails to sustain their position, fails to stay in the mind of the other person. And it's very simple and very easy to do. Send out a text message, make a call every once in a while, send a person an email just to stay in touch with them. If you have to utilize your Outlook or your Apple iCalendar, do it. Set yourself up with a reminder to stay in contact with the people that you influence. So again, we can go a lot more in depth in this. I don't want to take up too much of your time. So I'm giving you my simplified, broken down, five-step formula for Maverick Influence, the GRIPS method. Gather intelligence, reduce resistance, induce control, position yourself, and then sustain your position. Don't forget to subscribe to my YouTube channel so you can get access to more free videos like this. And also check out theinfluentialmind.com because I got a ton of articles and videos just like this for free. And there's also a nice free gift for you if you go over there. I'll talk to you soon.